you have a favorite ballet?
没有，我觉得芭蕾与我的文化无关。
Ballet is some shit.
是另外一种舞蹈，但是我不是金发，我也不是碧眼，我不是王子，我就是一个亚洲人的脸孔。所以当我看待芭蕾的时候，我觉得那是一种文化，然后我试图在理解这种文化。
So the only thing that I picked up, and is probably like the wrong thing, is like Phantom of the Opera. I was like, okay, Phantom of the Opera, not quite staging, but like I see where you're going with the
general. I say, for me, I'm not long, and I don't have, you know, like a typical face for prince.
Yeah.
So for me, it's a good training, and it's like a culture. So I try to understand the culture, and I learn from this culture.
That's cool. What do you think you have the face for?
You mean face for? Or?
You said you don't have the face of the prince. So what do you have the face for?
I mean, not for typical Western.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Prince face.
Okay.
我有什么样的脸孔？ 其实这个问题很好，因为 我在台湾的时候，常常会被误认成是日本人，或者是香港人，或者是从另外一个国家来的人。那有时候我也在想，到底我的脸孔到底代表的是什么？也许这位是持续不断的问题。I say, sometimes, even in Taipei, people feel I'm a Japanese or I'm come from Hong Kong or the other country.
Oh, okay.
But they don't feel I'm, you know, originally born in Taiwan or living in Taipei, Taiwan.
Mm-hmm.
So that is a good question for me. I always thinking, yeah, it made me think. What is this name, you know?
Mm-hmm.
What is my background? What is me, you know?
Yeah.
And it maybe, I will keep the question.
Yeah.
Continue.
Yeah. Ah, that's such a good answer. I'm with you there. I'm with you there. Yeah, no.
was incredible, wasn't it? I'd like to invite our amazing artists in residence out to join me. Inti, figgis-vizueta, and Chien-Wei Wu, who are going to join us for this Q&A. And we'd also like to invite Idea, who is going to help with translation for Chien-Wei. Well, thank you. That was so amazing. I'm just going to shift a little so I can see you. There you go. Welcome, everyone. My name is Ellie Weisenberg-Kelly, and I'm the Manager of Public Programs and Residencies here at the Pocantico Center. And it's my absolute pleasure to welcome you to today's Work in Process showing with Inti Figgis-Vizueta and Chien-Wei Wu. And welcome also to Idea, who will be doing the translation for us. The Pocantico Center rests in Lenape Hoking, unceded land of the native Lenape people. We honor the Lenape, past, present, and future, in gratitude and appreciation for their stewardship of this land for generations. We're going to get into a discussion about everything that we just saw and felt and heard in just a minute, but first I will talk more about the residents and offer some introductions. Inti Figgis-Vizueta and Chien-Wei Wu are artists in residence at the Pocantico Center this week as part of the Fall 2022 Collaborative Creative Residency Program between the Pocantico Center and the Rockefeller Brothers Fund, the Asian Cultural Council, and Composers Now. During the first half of November, in two consecutive weeks, composers chosen through a jury process administered by Composers Now are paired with fellows from the Asian Cultural Council. During each seven-day residency, two artists meet, reside on the campus of the Pocantico Center, and explore their combined forms and aesthetic approaches to conceive a joint project. Each pair will enjoy the natural environment, historic buildings, and art collection at Pocantico during the stay, and they have access to this performance space for rehearsal and collaboration. Each pair share meals and conversation in resident housing as they explore new artistic pathways. Each pair offers a work in process showing, and videographer Tatiana Tenenbaum is producing a short documentary on the artist's journey together. And the documentaries will be featured in the opening event of Composers Now 2023 Festival in late January. And now I'm pleased to introduce our pair of artists in residence this week. Inti Figgis-Vizueta's music attempts to reconcile historical aesthetics and experimental practices with trans and indigenous futures. Recent projects include a collaboration with Roomful of Teeth at Mass MoCA, a residency with So Percussion, and a fellowship from the Civitella Ranieri Foundation. Figgis-Vizueta is creating works for the Kronos Quartet and American Composers Orchestra with the Attica Quartet. Her music has been featured by music at Copeland House and at venues including Carnegie Hall and Lincoln Center. Chien-Wei Wu has been a full-time troupe member of Company Kafig in France, and the Taipei Crossover Dance Company in Taiwan. Today, Wu is the founder and director of Tusok Dance Company. His 2008 work, Aurora, won the Australian Choreography Competition Jury Honor Award, and Development and Restructuring won the 2014 Taiwan Creative Dance Competition. Welcome again. Thank you. So I'd love to start our conversation by talking about what we just experienced and how the piece came together. Maybe we can just kick it off there.
Yeah, I mean, this place is obviously beautiful, and the ability to kind of be here for this week, especially at hours when a lot of folks had gone home, so like after hours, kind of late at night, provided a lot of kind of inspiration for us to really explore the space, to feel really comfortable in it, and then to kind of start to reflect aspects of it and also document and capture parts of it. And I think we both had a real interest in kind of trying to really kind of contextualize and place what this collaboration was. So like using an instrument that's here, like taking photographs that are here, using interview that was here. Like it was this way of trying to really center and focus our relationship with one another through the work that we presented today.
Yeah. Wow. That's a lot.
So while I was living here, I was thinking all about the meaning that I was invited here. And I don't think there's a connection between I don't think my original work has a connection with here, but then I started trying to find the connection between my work and finally, for example, in the garden here, I was able to extract some of the very beautiful elements. There was very beautiful architecture that I was able to And then there was also a tree that I pass by every day when I go home, and I also tried to include this element into my work, and I treat this process as a very meaningful way for me to engage in this work, and including the way I interact with artists and include the way I interact with the environment.
That's great. I think that was so evident in the piece that we saw, and I wonder if you both can talk a little bit more about those different aspects. We were just experiencing, I feel like, a sound bath in so many levels between this incredible sculpture that we'll talk about and explain in a minute, and also the audio that we were hearing, the water, the conversation. Could you talk a little bit more about what that was and how it all came together with the choreography? Either one of you.
Did you want to go ahead? Yeah. So I think kind of, again, with this kind of centering of our time here together, all the aspects of the show were kind of derived from materials that we had kind of collected here. So part of that is, for example, the photography that Jemma was just talking about, that tree, which is, I think, the first or second, oh no, it's that one. That's the tree that we walk home and see every single time we go out. And so this kind of experience of being with one another and walking and exploring and all of this stuff was what we wanted to kind of bring into this space. And so part of that, for example, is like that audio interview portion was late one night when we decided that the fountain was a really beautiful location and had a really beautiful acoustic. And we've kind of placing ourselves in that space together, I feel like we were able to kind of have a conversation that couldn't be had somewhere else. And so I think that's kind of what we were trying to find, were these kinds of things that were like unfilterable or something, you know, like something that like had such a kind of strong identity and presence and moment that we were able to kind of bring it into this space and have it really kind of, I guess, shine was the feeling. The choreography, the sculpture, all of these things were kind of collected over our time here. And so there's like, you know, we have so much more material, right? Like I think I have like something like 30 minutes of audio that we had, you know, or even more. And so having to kind of filter that down and make really kind of clear decisions was also a joy. And Chien-Wei would always remind me that like simple is best. I like to go. I think these dialogues really informed both the materials that we selected and drew, but then also our kind of collaborative process of working together and then kind of creating something really, really tight and really, really, contained.
So firstly, I really want to appreciate the fund has kindly offered these beautiful sculptures to me. It really means a lot to me and also inspired me a lot. And on the choreography part, I really value group collaboration. I wouldn't put choreography solely as the number one priority, but I will also put visual effect and our team as the first priorities. And also when I was living with Inti, I had a lot of time to make conversation with him, and we were able to communicate with a lot of details and cultural communication. So I came from countryside, and it was it's really hard to find a complete quietness and darkness in the city, and I come from countryside, so this is why I really enjoy the experience here.
You felt right at home.
Yes.
Well, you brought up a good point about language that I think is a really interesting thing to explore. There are some obvious language barriers here between the two of you, and I'm just wondering if how you found the ability to communicate without a common spoken language, and in what ways did you maybe compensate for a lack of that commonality, and how you worked through those throughout your collaboration.
Hello again. I mean, honestly, it was an exciting prospect for me. I'm from Washington, D.C. We have the kind of immigrant and like ESL and ELL populations in D.C. have been communities that I've grown up around my entire life. And there's so many other ways to communicate, like really complex concepts, like just sounds, direction, all this kind of artistic dialogue. And I think through the kind of lens of a project together, we were able to kind of really focus and like find, kind of struggle through some concepts sometimes, but also like, I think also have a really kind of clear connection in kind of what our goals were. And I think part of that is observation, part of that is seeing how both of us kind of interact in the space, what we're looking towards, what details pop out to us, what do we bring each other's gaze or notice to. But on the other side, like the conversation was, it never, at least for me, never felt difficult. I think for me, like there's, my job is to interpret things and to make things for other people to interpret. So it's not a kind of hard jump to shift from that in a kind of musical and directional practice to one of communication. So it wasn't really a barrier. It actually felt like a place where it was really porous, and I feel like we were able to go back and forth a lot.
So I never think language is a problem. The point in our communication is how much I desire to let inti to understand my thoughts and what I want to do. And I think inti is a very great listener, and we never encounter a communication problem. And this is also what is really precious, which is to break the constraint of language and our culture and to complete something together.
So true. I want to talk a little bit about rituals and the day-to-day experience of what living together has been like for you this week. And we should point out, if it's not already clear, that inti and Chien-Wei had never met before. They came here on Monday and had not had, I believe, any communication at all before arriving here. And then they were put into this resident housing here and living together and the task of creating this amazing piece that we saw. And so I'm just wondering if, you know, sharing a kitchen and, you know, being together in that domestic way while you're collaborating helped shape the relationship and how so.
Hello again. it was a beautiful time. This is kind of a new experience for me. I have come to residencies before, but often it's like there is this kind of separation of the domestic and the artistic. And I feel like that, again, that space I think was really particularly valuable when we're talking about this kind of building of communication and building of a kind of artistic dialogue that then we can kind of place into our work. I think our best conversations and probably a clue, you know, like the conversations about like the direction that we wanted to take, the materials we were gathering, all that. I mean, it all happened in the kitchen with like a glass of wine. Like, you know, it was very much like we put chairs in the kitchen, you know, there were no chairs in the kitchen, we put chairs in the kitchen, you know, I think, at least for the house where I came to, the kitchen is actually the place that you hang out, not really anywhere else in the house. And so I think that we both really kind of naturally came into it. And I remember Chien-Wei said this very funny thing the first night, which was, you know, it's rare to be able to share a kitchen with another person, and when you know that you can, because we were cooking at the same time, when you can, there's this kind of a connection that you can kind of build on. And I feel like from that kind of, first meal, like it really, like, I think sharing these things was really important, and made it so that we were really comfortable when, you know, this piece went through many forms in the 4 or 5 days we've been here. It's really good to get material. It's really, really good when you can cut material. Like, it's like, you know, when you're able to kind of have the trust to shave excess off, to really kind of all that. And to me, that comfort also came from that kind of sharing of ritual.
So in our culture, food is the fastest way and the most effective way to communicate love. I also think this is a best way to comprehend different culture, which is food. And so for me, what is special in this collaboration is that I was able to share a kitchen with him the first night that I arrived. And from that moment, I predicted that we'll have a perfect collaboration together.
I'm sad I wasn't invited to dinner. Well, maybe you're not. I want to talk about this amazing sculpture sitting here in front of us that was performed so beautifully by inti. It is a son ambient tonal sculpture by the artist Harry Bertoya, and it's been on loan to the residents this week. I would love to hear, inti, your process with the discovery of the piece and how it ended up shaping what we saw today, which, as you had mentioned, this was not how you started out in developing this presentation, and how this piece fit into the overall experience about not only the presentation, but the residency and everything that you've learned, you know, about the Pocantico.
Definitely. Totally. I'm pretty sure this sculpture was mentioned the first day, maybe even at lunch, at our welcome
yes.
lunch. You know, I think it's always a really, and a Arnaldo shout out to make that happen. I think as artists, but also this could just be me, like I am always looking for something that I can't touch anywhere else. You know, when I'm going somewhere, like, you know, it could be a really beautiful tree, it could be a rock, you know, but this kind of sense of something that is tied to a place, that is something that I'm able to interact with for only a limited amount of time, makes it feel really special. Mm-hmm. So, you know, for the first few days, what we had been developing was not oriented around the sculpture. Permission for all the workings to kind of get it into the spot that it was at, and, you know, kind of multiple steps and a lot of, you know, kind of responsible looking at whether it's, you know, it felt good and all that stuff. But I think once it kind of entered the space and once it became clear that we wanted to really kind of have it as part, and it was literally like the first time we looked at it in our house and saw its form, we were like, all right, this is it. Like, you know, this has to be the kind of thing. And it's such a, you know, it's such a beautiful piece. I don't think it could be like a sideline. Like I feel like it has to be like right in front. And so, you know, we've had it for maybe a day and a half, you know, maybe that, or maybe even less, maybe a day actually. And, you know, one of my favorite things with instruments that I don't know how to play, or, you know, don't actually have a way, you know, a kind of established technique for playing them, is always around kind of developing my own with the instrument. And that is my absolute favorite thing to do. So you did not have to ask me twice. And, you know, it's been kind of a growing interest of mine of touching old sounding objects and really kind of trying to either build new pieces with them, integrate them with other pieces that I'm making, or in this case, use them actually as like the prime kind of communicator and almost like sound building with someone else. And I think both of our kind of newness to the sound, really, yeah, like we were just gushing over it. Like we, you know, it arrived the first day, we made a bunch of sounds, I made a bunch of not great sounds, and then I made better sounds. And so, you know, I think even this thing over a day, it gives you a kind of momentum that then we can arrive here today and really feel like it's core and fundamental to it.
I think you've helped us all who know Pocantico, those of you who have taken a tour and seen the Oceanus Fountain, for example, that was in one of Wu Chien-Wei's photographs, and sculptures, which we all know the Pocantico Center is known for, to see all these things differently, to hear the running water at the Oceanus versus looking at the visual aspect of it, to look at a sculpture but then hear this beautiful sound coming out of it. You've given us all the opportunity to look at these beautiful things in a completely different light, so that's very, very special. I want to ask one more question and then we'll open it up for some Q&A. What do you envision as the continuation or next steps for this collaboration and or the piece, and where do you see it going from here?
Okay. I feel like there's, you know, there's a lot of interesting, really site-specific things that we've done here that I feel like we could really kind of lean into. I know that there's a lot of material that kind of we got over time. There's even more material to kind of be had. I know that we were kind of thinking about different parts of the garden itself as kind of potential expansions of certain things. And then I just feel like with, we tried to be as kind of simple and bare and precise as possible with what we showed you today. But just like our process of building kind of went off in so many different directions, and, you know, we kind of cut those branches and cut those ones, you know, kind of thing. And so I think if kind of moving forward, if we're able to kind of keep pursuing this work, it'll be about maybe finding some of those again. I think also time is this really interesting thing that being here for only a week is a really beautiful experience. It's really fast. and, you know, I think that, you know, we had kind of reflected that, you know, if we'd been here another week, mm-hmm. then this would have been completely different, mm-hmm. you know, and I think that kind of sense of the ability to kind of add on, something that we really want to kind of take moving forward. And also, I would love to come back and see this beauty, But yeah.
So as an artist, I feel very lucky to have this special collaboration. And I also think it's a very unforgettable memory that the fund allows me to use this beauty. And I think this sculpture has really added the weight to my artwork, my dance performance. And under the support of all these people, I really hope that I can like, turn my work in progress into a complete project in the future.
That's so exciting. I hope you do. And you'll come back and perform it for us.
Heck yeah.
Well, thank you. I'd love to see if we have any questions from the audience. Yes, go ahead.
Totally. So I started making music pretty intuitively as a kid. In DC, there wasn't kind of a lot of opportunities for kind of formal instrumental lessons, but I participated in a lot of kind of community music making, things like open mics, drum, you know, kind of drum circles every week, ways of making music that were kind of much more about kind of an immediacy, a spontaneity, a teaching in that moment, kind of building a vocabulary that way. So a lot of like kind of learning patterns and reflecting them back, changing them, all that. I started studying mandolin in college, and kind of part of that was also an introduction to the piano. And then in the last few years, because of the pandemic especially, and the kind of distance that I had from a lot of the string instruments, and most of the music I write is for strings, I kind of started to learn how to play a little bit of the viola and some of the violin, and kind of had brought those instruments as sound sources at first, and then kind of it was a beautiful accident that I had a bow and rosin, and this particular instrument just sings under a bow. Totally. It's actually more the opposite. This is a first for me in a lot of ways. The ability to collaborate across genre is something that when I was in conservatory, I wasn't actually able to kind of I wasn't able to do that as much. There was a lot of kind of partitioning between mediums and practices, and so being able to actually come here has felt like a deep interest for a long time, and kind of having that opportunity made was really beautiful. And so for the most part, what I write is notated music for string quartets, for orchestras, for, you know, like much more when I'm not on the stage. I'm very aware, you know, I'm kind of in the, you know, I'm where you are, looking, you know, kind of looking and listening. And so that kind of ability to enter a space that I've been interested in for a long time, but not able to really explore in the kind of wider compositional practice of mine.
Not knowing each other and then coming together, like what was the beginning stages like?
Okay. for me, there's often, you know, one is wide ears, right? And I think wide eyes. And I think wide eyes for this one and probably really wide ears for me. I arrived and immediately you hear the birds, the insects, like this environment is really sonically rich. And so part of kind of finding, part of that was arriving and hearing that. And then the other one was kind of, again, this, I think one of the easiest and most fundamental ways as an artist to kind of collaborate with someone else is to make something and show it to them. And then you're like, do you like it? Do you not? You know, like in this way of like kind of, you build a vocabulary, and that vocabulary can be either through documentation, it can be through manipulation of source material, it can be any of that stuff. And so for this residency in particular, we arrived, there was that kind of like focus, these beautiful, it was impossible to ignore how beautiful this environment is. I think when you're in a space like that, and also a space with a lot of history, this campus, you kind of have a decision. Like, do you engage that history in some way? Do you engage that place? Do you make that place closer to yourself? Do you hold it very far? You know, like, what is that kind of relationship? And I think for us, like, again, on these like kind of like late night walks, this exploring, this kind of spending a lot of time together, talking a lot, I think that there was a way in which we both were really paying attention to our environment and realized that the environment was actually the medium that we would be able to kind of extract and then have a lot of commonalities in that kind of sourcing.
So I think this process is actually like a deductive novel, and every new question we raise is like providing a new clue for us. The more clue there are, the more question there are, and it will actually target down what we want to focus on, including the environments, including what we see, including the history, the life, and the natural things.
Yeah, I'll say there were a lot of really happy surprises for me. Like when you arrive and another artist is on it, like, you know, it really takes off a lot of pressure to immediately like frantically search, like, what am I gonna do? You know, I think with that sense, like, I didn't know, for example, that Chen-Wei was such an amazing photographer, right? That like that a kind of visual component would be such a like space building element of what we would eventually present, and so in those regards, like, there were a lot of things that I think we both were kind of uncovering in each other's practices. Because, you know, when we came here, it's like composer, dancer, you know, like, what do we do, you know? And you know that I think we're both kind of interested in moving past just a pure kind of experience of those two and a traditional experience of those two together. And so I think the fact that we both kind of really, I think, attempted to start from a ground zero, attempted to start from a, like, what are the like aesthetic and process values of both people, made it so that we could just add on all the things we were kind of good at or like interested in or really, you know, all of that. And then able to just like be like, oh, does it work? Okay, let's change this to white. Let's do, you know, like eventually it becomes a really simple kind of thing. But I feel like as most artists know, it's really rare to have that be easy. Like, it's often like a struggle and tears are involved, and there were no tears this week, so.
So I was observing throughout the process as well, and so I knew what was he thinking in a way, and I tried to use my ability to assist him and to make things complete, And I also think he's treating me the same way. So in this way, we are able to present a more complete and fulfilled performance.
I thought there was a sense of drama in this fluidity and beauty of your movement. And I wonder, while you were here, if you had this sense of doomsday, or in the, it's not pastoral, it's more drama. Is that my interpretation, or is that something you found?
So I think it's difficult for us to distinguish all the types of art because we are engaging with different kind of information. So everything that can inspire our thinking is good artwork, in my opinion. And so every movement I did was sentimental and emotional, and I believe that they all had some kind of meaning, delivery, purpose.
Yeah, and I'll just say from my end, again, it's a rare pleasure to be able to be next to someone who's giving so much information, so much direction, so much just variation of motion, of feeling, of all of these things, and including the mask that's Chen-Wei's face, the coat that expands the silhouette, the reach. All these things are, to me, extremely musical, and being able to respond to them and build off of them and feel like when I really back off, Chen-Wei will fill, and when I'm filling, you know, like, just that there's just a dynamic relationship that we're able to tap into as we're kind of exploring these things in real time. Also, just I think I really got to compliment your sense of structure. I think that being able to really kind of like clear out, really having real kind of points that we can like align and feel into, made it so that we're able to kind of really create dynamic changes between places, and to me, those are some of the core elements of communicating emotion and drama.
Madeline?
Thank you for a fascinating and beautiful experience. It really was wonderful. But can you speak to the dialogue that was going on behind the scenes and how it related to what we saw visually and heard?
Can George, can we show some different images from the slideshow? There we go. Thank you.
So as you can see, that part is actually a fountain, and we chose this fountain here because we actually filmed here as well. And I believe this part, this fountain, is what Rockefeller family has constructed about the view of beauty. And I think this actually overlaps with what we want to do culturally, and this is why we chose this.
Can we change the slide again, please? This one?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Okay, thank you.
So this picture here shows the side of the garden, and there's like flowers and bees here. And I believe this is a part of history in this place. And this is also what we want to target on for as the nature part. And we kind of transform this material here and express it through our work.
And next slide, please. Thank you.
So right here, there's my shadow on both sides, and there's also the tree that I pass by every day. And this is what this picture represents what I feel every day when I walk past these places. And I feel like it contains part of me, and part of me and my friend who I work on with this project.
And yeah, I'll just say that I believe you're talking about the kind of voice portion of the audio. So that was done pretty late at night. We had both kind of decided to go on this walk with the specific notion of recording and speaking near and underneath the fountain. This kind of sense of, I think I always have this idea about waterfalls and this kind of element of movement, protection, and sound. You know, it all is just such a rich, beautiful sound. And when we were near the water fountain, you know, we kind of, it was as simple as like, we were like, okay, we'll ask a question and answer in Mandarin and then answer in English. And we're gonna try and like, you know, get the real, the sense of familiarity and flow that we have with our native tongues and be able to kind of feel the difference and even just like the way in which the speaking might occur. And so we had a kind of long, maybe 10 or 15 minute kind of interview where we were speaking about this stuff. We ended up just extracting a little bit of it. But in particular, I think was just this idea of part of what we were sharing is almost what our context is within our own genres, mediums, cultures, homes, all these things. And this kind of sense of like, you know, you're like, well, in this place, this is how I'm interacted with. This is how people look at what I do. This is how all of this. And so I think being able to kind of share ways in which we both feel understood and misunderstood about certain aspects of how we approach art, how we make art, all these things, felt like it was really, that space in particular was a place where that conversation flowed where I don't know if it would have flowed in another context. So I think part of, to me, this kind of process of almost placing yourself, like there's making art and then there's putting yourself in the situation where art can be made. And that was kind of that, that sense of like, this is so quiet, this is so delicate, this is like there's no time limit, there's no audience, there's nothing, let's just interact with one another and record it. And then eventually, when we were kind of compiling this final project, this interview was so, it felt like such strong material, such strong kind of communication that we ended up just cutting so much stuff around it just for the sake of really centering it. Mm-hmm. And I think that this is kind of what I mean when I'm talking about this kind of, this tightness of just like not letting excess in, just really focusing on the really specific, beautiful things that we found in our short time together.
Last question, Arnaldo.
My curiosity is, you were
So I think my choices has come back to the art piece itself. So if I want to focus on nature, I don't really have to do a artwork because there is the most beautiful site outside that we can visit all the time. So what is most important in our work is to deliver the message that we want to show you. And when I try to transform this message, I want to show our different angles as we, the creator and you, the audiences.
I asked you this also yesterday. I was watching a little bit of their rehearsals. And I just think it's so incredible how you have changed. You give us an opportunity to change our perspective of what we see here on the estate by just the shadows and the light and not necessarily those bright, beautiful colors. And you've given us all, through both of your work, a chance to rediscover this place through your artistic vision. And we just have to thank you so much for that. Every aspect of this collaboration was really one of discovery and innovation. And I speak for all of us that we can't wait to see what may happen from this collaboration. I want to thank you both so much for today and for being here with us this week. And Idea, thank you so much for your help. You did a great job. And also to thank the partnership that we have between the Asian Cultural Council and Composers Now. It's just been a wonderful example of all of our organizations collaborating together and bringing these two amazing artists together. So thank you all so much. Join us for reception and a gathering space behind you, and our gallery is open as well if you'd like to see the exhibition. Hope to see you soon. Thank you.